one thing that Lorenz noticed, let me start this again. This is showing the XZ plane, so the XZ projection. And he noticed that if you looked at the peak of Z, right, that seemed to be a predictor of what the next peak of Z would be. That for some periods of time, the peak of Z, the local peak, is just getting bigger and bigger. And then you have a jump to the other side. So he did something with that information, dynamics along the Lorenz attractor. And what he does is a reduction to a 1D map. So we will talk about a 1D map here before we kind of discuss it properly later. This is in section 9.4 of Strogatz. So the values that I've been showing, those are sigma 10, B equals 8/3, R equals 28. You know what it looks like. It seemed to do, it's kind of going around and then it would do something like this. I don't know if I'm doing it right, but then at some point it would go around. So if we just looked at the peaks of Z, we'll label them. So if we turn this into a time series of Z, what you would get is that there's this, you know, time series, and then maybe it jumps and whatever. But just look at the peaks, and this is in Lorenz's paper. So he'll label the, if he's following a time series, starting at time zero, the nth peak in Z, he'll call Zn. So then the next peak is Zn plus one. And he had the idea to look at a plot of Zn plus one versus Zn, just to see if there was any pattern to it. And I'll just show what he got. If you follow a time series like this, it's not going to fill out completely. There's this, we're just showing this 45 degree line because it'll be useful later. The points we're actually talking about are these things that look like they're sort of separated, and it seems to fall on a line. If I were to draw a line through it, it comes to a kind of a peak and then it goes down, and it's discrete, and you have these gaps because you would need to follow this initial condition forever. But eventually it will seem to, all the points will seem to fall on a curve of essentially no thickness, so meaning a band. There is some thickness, but Lorenz wants to make an argument based on this. It looks like a function. It looks like we have Zn plus one is some function of Zn, right? If you give me Zn, this tells you where it will go. Now, one of the key things about this that will be important, this 45 degree line, that's where the slope equals one. And notice, at least for this first part, before it gets to its peak, the slope is greater than one. And actually after that peak, the slope is always less than one. So the magnitude of the slope is always greater than one. And that's going to be important. It means that if you were to differentiate this curve everywhere except that top point, forget about that top point, differentiate this curve, you'll always get that it's greater than one, at least for all Z where this is defined. So Lorenz got the idea, maybe you could iterate Z to study the dynamics. This 45 degree line, this is the line where Zn plus one equals Zn. So where that curve would intersect the red curve, that's where we would have a fixed point of this map. I'll highlight it here and call that Z star. So we could use this map to study the dynamics. Now, why does it seem to fall on a curve? I don't know, but he noticed that it did. There's this point Z star where Z star equals F of Z star. And I forget, you know, what it is. It's something around 40, but it suggests that there's a periodic orbit, right? Whatever trajectory would correspond to that point is going to be periodic. And what would that look like? I'm going to try to draw these going to the same height. All right, this is Z, here's Zn, and here's Zn plus one. And they're at the exact same height as this goes around. If you actually find that point numerically, I'll show it here. So this seems to mean that on the attractor, there's a periodic orbit. But what's important is to know, is it stable? If it's an if it's unstable, then it's not going to be an attractor. So we could ask, you know, is Z star stable in terms of this map? And then that will tell us if it's stable. Here it is. Is this periodic orbit stable? If the Z value isn't even stable, then the whole thing isn't stable. So we could just look at the map and ask, is this stable? Right. This question is about the three-dimensional ODEs. And one of the nice things about maps and how they get used, but sometimes you can reduce the dynamics of, or some question about the dynamics of a differential equation, turn it into a map, and then it's easier to answer. In this case, we could ask, is Z star stable? And I guess we could ask specifically, is it stable under the map? And we could go back to the way that we looked at stability for one-dimensional ODEs. There will be some modification for maps. We'll let Zn equal Z star plus something small that I'll call eta n. And eta n is very small. Eta n, much, much less than one, the magnitude of it. It could be positive or negative. So how do we get at the stability? We'll say that Zn plus one equals Z star plus eta n plus one. So there'll be some perturbation. We want to know, how does this perturbation grow? So the question will boil down to, how does perturbation eta n away from the fixed point of the map grow? So how do we figure that out? Well, Zn plus one would also, according to the map, be f of Zn. And plug in what we've assumed for the form of Zn. We're looking very close to the fixed point. So this will be f of Z star plus eta n. Now we'll do a Taylor series expansion of this function about Z star. Taylor series expansion. So this is f of Z star plus eta n f prime at Z star plus terms that are of order 2 or greater in eta n, but eta n is very small. So just looking at the linear term should be enough. Because we've got a fixed point of the map, that means Z star equals f of Z star. So Z star here and f of Z star, it's like they cancel. So we have a map for how the perturbations grow. Eta n plus one equals approximately, we'll ignore things that are of order 2 or higher in this small perturbation, f prime Z star times eta n. Now, recall from up here, the slope, the magnitude of the slope is everywhere greater than one, including at the point Z star. So what this means is that the magnitude of that perturbation is always going to be greater than the magnitude of the, even an infinitesimally small initial perturbation. So we conclude from that that the point Z star in this map is unstable, meaning the local Z maximum, it's either going to grow or shrink. So this is an unstable, I would write it over here, it's an unstable periodic orbit. And we get that from Z star is unstable, at least in terms of the map. Therefore, the periodic orbit is also unstable. So at least we know that's not stable. So the dynamics on the Lorentz attractor, at least they're not going to settle down to that. But you might say, well, maybe there's longer periods. And so this gets into looking at this map in terms of a cobweb diagram. Let me insert that figure again. So this is to get at the question, maybe there are larger periods. But first, the cobweb diagram approach to iterating a map. Let me first draw what looks like a continuous red curve through here. So this will also be useful when we talk about 1D maps that have nothing to do with differential equations, just 1D maps. You draw the map And a 1D map can always be plotted as a curve. And then you do the 45 degree angle line, or slope equals one. What we want to do is start with an initial condition and see what happens to it. And there's a nice geometric construction for that, which is called a cobweb diagram. So you start with some initial condition. And so I'll do things in blue. Let's start with this as our initial condition. So I'll call this Z naught. That's a Z naught. I go upwards. Here's where I am. So this tells me if I've got this as Z naught, my Z1 would be this point right along the axis. But the quick way to do that is you just go horizontally to the diagonal. And so that gives me what my Z1 is. It's an easy way to interpret. And then I go vertically to the graph of FZ. So in this case, I go down. And so that will tell me, again, going horizontally, that'll tell me what the next point is. So now this is Z2. It takes some getting used to. So what am I doing? Going horizontally to the diagonal and then vertically, maybe up or down to the graph of FZ. And then I repeat. And what I'm getting is a trajectory of a map can be obtained this way. The trajectory of a map is starting with some initial condition. Then you get what the next, we say, iterate of the map is. C2, C3, et cetera, as far as you want to go. So that's the initial condition. And then Z1 is actually F of Z naught. Z2 is F of Z1, which is actually two iterates. It's F of Z naught. You could write that as shorthand, two iterates of Z naught. And you could keep following this. So if I wanted to get Z3, you know, maybe this goes up here. I go to the nearest point. Tells me go here, go down here. In some sense, this is illustrating exactly how unstable that point Z star is, because I happen to pick an initial condition close to Z star. And then this would take me right over there. So this would be what, Z3. So it looks like it's jumping around. Then I go to here, then I go to here, go to here, go to here. And it's just goes on and on and on. So this is the cobweb diagram approach to looking at the dynamics of a 1D map. So you might ask, can we have a periodic orbit? Could we pick an initial condition that actually comes back to itself? The simplest one is just the Z star case. Z star goes back exactly to itself, but maybe there's initial conditions, this cobweb, maybe after many iterates, comes back to itself. This is the trajectory of a map, or sometimes called the orbit of a map. The periodic orbit of a map is a periodic sequence of points, Z0, Z1, Z2, Z3, and then it repeats after some amount of time. Zn plus P equals Zn for all n. We would call this a period P orbit because it repeats itself after P. So a fixed point of a map is a period one orbit, but maybe there could be period two, period three, period four. I don't know. Could we find a periodic orbit? Are there periodic orbits of period P greater than one? We could imagine that. We draw that diagonal line and, you know, here's my stylistic sketch of what that thing looks like. We could probably find some initial condition that would come back onto itself after some number of iterates. Ooh, does this do it? Actually, this seems to settle down into a period two. Here we have a period two. So maybe there's a period two. I don't know. But hopefully you get the idea. We could possibly find initial conditions that are periodic. So I would say the answer is yes. Can a periodic orbit like this be stable? And maybe it has a very long, arbitrarily long period. If so, then the Lorentz attractor isn't chaotic. It wouldn't be aperiodic. It would just be periodic with a very long period. Now we can show that these are not stable. The answer is no. And it has to do with the fact the magnitude of the slope is everywhere greater than one. If you have z naught, and that goes to z1, which is f of z naught, z2 is f of z naught. In this period two case, one of these might be called, you know, z naught, and the other's z1. And it just, this thing, if you were to start exactly on that initial condition, it's just going to keep going between the two forever. Is this stable? Well, z1 is f of z naught. Z naught is f of z naught because it goes back to itself. So we could say this is f squared z naught. For period p, zn plus p equals f of p zn. We could say that for any point in a period p orbit of f, it is actually a fixed point of the map of p iterates of f. So we just need to find out what's the stability of points under p iterates of f. So let's just look at a period two point. Suppose we have a period two orbit. A point z on this is a fixed point of f2. So that means we're looking at z equals f2 z. And we could use the same sort of stability. F2 of z, take its derivative, right? It'd be using the same argument of looking at perturbations, we could look at perturbations of two iterates of the map. If you want, we've sort of defined a new map, capital F, and it's f2. So f z prime f2. And what will this be? Well, we need to use the chain rule. So it's going to be d by d z. This is just the definition of the derivative of f of z, which is f prime evaluated at f of z times f prime z. And now just take the magnitude. All we need to care about is the magnitude. So I'll put magnitude of this is going to be the magnitude of f prime evaluated at some point times the magnitude evaluated at some other point. And of course, both of these are greater than one because the slope anywhere along is greater than one. So then this will be greater than one. So any period p point of that map has been called the Lorentz map is unstable for any p. It's not quite a proof because that thing that I called a map has a little bit of width. So it's not exactly a map. But this was the argument that Lorentz made to say that, no, what you're seeing in that attractor, it's not something that's just periodic with an arbitrarily long period because those would be unstable. So nothing would ever settle down to that. In fact, if you notice for period P orbits, they're actually, you know, more unstable than just that fixed point. So yes, you can find things that are periodic and will go back on themselves after some number of loops. And I don't know what they'll do. They'll do something, but they're all unstable for any P. So no stable periodic orbits, at least in that regime that we're talking about. So this was the argument that this is indeed a chaotic attractor. The Lorentz attractor is a chaotic attractor. I think it's clever and pretty cool and worth pondering. We're going to leave vector fields for a while, one-dimensional maps, and that's what we're going to be talking about next.